Very good morning to all the dignitaries and the faculty of D.Y. Patil, and of course, a very good morning to the students who have organized this. Some weeks ago, Rajiv called me up, and he said that I was a student, and I would like you to take a lecture. The first thing I told him was that, see, I'm a surgeon. Mera bheja to dehati hai. I always tell people, surgeons are something which is not the so intelligent faculty of medicine. Medicine people are those intellectuals. We are just dehati hai. Samajh mein nahi aata, khol ke dekh le yaar, kaam khatam. Forget about it. That's the priority we have. So what can I teach the students? He said, no, sir, you can take any topic you want. And that's the time I suddenly felt this has been a thing for me very close to my heart. A topic which I thought everybody will suddenly say, what is this romancing with medicine? And I want to tell you that this is one thing which has been dear to my heart, that as to how I started liking medicine and how did I start my romance with medicine. Okay, as I like to start first, let's face this point. All romance always starts with hatred. You know that very well. When you start liking a girl, the first thing you hate that girl, the girl hates you, and yes. But then romance blossoms. So also my story starts that way. This is a universal phenomenon. In 1974 was the year I entered medical school with a total dislike for medicine. I would like to give an explanation why I did not like medicine and how I went on to like medicine later on. Before 1974, I was a child. As a child, I was that totally an outdoor guy, hated studies. As to any street fight that used to happen, I used to be there. School fights, I used to be there. Studies, I was the last. My brother and my sister, you must have heard of my brother Gopinath Shenoy, and my sister, they were board rankers. They were that state board rankers in the 50s. My mother used to be horrified. My cousins used to call me to level scores with their neighbors, used to come and beat them up. So, Sharad ko bulao yaar, zara hissa barabar karne ka, that kind of a thing. And my mother used to get horrified listening to the stories. She used to always tell me, why can't you just study like your brother and sister? I mean, what is wrong with you? I used to always tell, see, I don't like studies. But one thing is definite, I'll give you a first class every time. If you want ranks, you ask your daughter, you ask your son, don't ask me, please. So that was the story which was there. The outdoor phenomena, 1968, came in the picture, where I was 12 years old. I suddenly took to another passion, and that passion was swimming. I started swimming for the simple reason my general practitioner told my mother, he put him to swim, his asthma will go away. And that's the reason why I started swimming. And I started to like swimming. At the same time, I wanted to go into competitive swimming. My brother, elder brother, was in a program with one of the good coaches for swimming. So I asked him, is it possible for you to put in a word for me? So he looked at me, the vagabond that I looked over there. He said that, you're the useless, you can't do anything, just forget about it. Some time back, someone had asked me for an interview. Who is your idol? Who is your icon in life? And suddenly I looked back and I thought that I am my own icon. My disabilities, my faults promote me or motivate me to go further in life. So my brother told me this, suddenly I said, I should do something about it. My image has to change. So I went to the next best coach that was there in the pool. And the very first year that I started swimming, I represented the state at the age of 12 in high board diving, on the 10-meter board and 5-meter board. And then after that, there was just no looking back. I went on to get the state championship. I became the national champion for butterfly, 100 meters butterfly. I was a national champion for freestyle. I was the intercollegiate champion 5 times in a row. I was the state captain, the university captain, inter-varsity champion. Look, whatever that came in swimming, I took up to water polo. I excelled in that. I was the youngest water polo player at 16, working for a senior team. That was the youngest in those days. At 16, I represented the Maharashtra State senior water polo match. And later on, of course, swimming became like a passion. And this is one thing, the first lesson that I learned in my life. The 3 words which guided my life. One is the courage to acquire the skill or the knowledge. And second, the confidence to implement that knowledge. These 3 things, when I went swimming, I said, I should get charged, I should get fired. And with that passion, I went on working. This went on till 1972 when I graduated from my SSE. And the first time an educational accolade was loaded on me, I came second in the board in general science, getting 98 on 100, which I thought was, even I was surprised how I got it in the first place. But I got it over there. My mother was very happy. Arey, ladka line pe lag gaya abhi. Came 1974 into science. That's when I entered the medical. I got the marks, but my mother said, you're going to go to medicine. I said, of course not. I want to go in the army. I had filled up my NDA form. I got a call for the exam also. My mother was just taken aback. He says, you're getting a medical education here, because my brother and my sister already were in medical. So why should you shouldn't go there? So I said, no, I don't like it. So then my mother trained her army. She got her cousin nephew, who was in the CID, in the police. So he said, "Arey, aisa kaisa ho sakta hai? My brother, my sister, all tried brainwashing me. Arey, you should take up medicine. Aisa kaisa hota hai?" So ultimately, I landed up in medicine. So 74, I entered medicine with a total dislike. I never liked all these schools. Padhai vidhai kon karte baithega? So something which was not my forte at all. So I used to swim hell of a lot. And for a medical career, for a medical school, that was the first year that medical student and medical team became first in the Bombay University, unheard of. A state captain and an inter-varsity champion, Bombay University champion, a medical graduate. So I became the darling of the college over there. Everybody said, hey, kya karta hai, kya padhai karta hai? I started slowly saying, let me see what this subject is. And some things changed my mind that time. The first time is a peon by the name of Savant in physiology department. When I went to the college, I used to be that I'd come out from Xavier's. All the polo neck shirts, bell-bottom pants. In those days, we had those bell-bottom high-heel shoes, long hair, that kind of a thing. So what he told me fitted in my mind so profitably, in the sense, he said, I was by that time swimming champion, so he said that he had the right to talk to me. So he said, listen, yaar, ek baga lakshya tha, tumhi phude jaun doctor banna rahe. A normal lay person has got a layout for that doctor. तुम्ही असे शर्ट पॅन्ट वगैरे घालता, तुम्ही पार्टीसाठी आलात का डॉक्टर व्हायला आलात तुम्ही? फॉर टू मिनिट्स इट स्टक मी. इट सेज व्हॉट इज सेईंग इज ॲब्सोल्युटली ट्रू. दॅट इज द लास्ट टाइम आय वोर दोज पोलर नेक टू कॉलेज. आय वोर अ रेग्युलर शर्ट अँड अ पॅन्ट इन कॉलेज. आउटसाइड द कॉलेज डू व्हॉट यू वॉन्ट, दॅट्स नो क्वेश्चन. द फर्स्ट प्रिन्सिपल लेड आउट ओवर दॅट बाय दॅट प्यून ओवर देअर. अँड आय ऑलवेज कीप ऑन टेलिंग पीपल, एव्हरी टाइम इन लाईफ यू कॅन लर्न समथिंग फ्रॉम एव्हरीबडी. फ्रॉम सम पीपल यू लर्न व्हॉट टू डू. From others, you learn what not to do also. Though he was a peon, he taught me one lesson, that there are some etiquettes in being a doctor. After that, I stopped wearing polo necks in college. Regular shirt pant was my forte. During this time, slowly as I was going around, I was studying as much as I needed to pass. I went to the library one day. You must have seen that Om Shanti, not Om Shanti, which is that Shah Rukh Khan movie, where that Zahid Khan comes to the library and people started aarti nikalta uska. So that was the situation that I was in. I went to the library. Two of my colleagues were reading physiology. So I said, what, kya padh raha bhai tu? So he said, arey tu ja yaar, tapori tu ja, tu apne ko barbaad karega, tu tera ja swimming kar le. Once again, this insult was something which I could not bear. Just like what my brother did to me, this fellow did to me, I said, I should do something about it. And then I took to studying, and I said, I should teach something. And after that, at the end of first MBBS, I realized that I came first in physiology, the same subject that he was still studying. I came first in the university that time with physiology. I said, that boy was just taken aback. I said, nahi yaar, koi apne ko bole to hota hai kuch idhar yaar. And that's the passion driven that I keep on talking about. Courage to have the knowledge and the confidence to implement it. That was first MBBS. Second MBBS, I continued swimming. I was, by that time, national champion. The dean was totally gaga over me. I became the outdoor secretary. And being outdoor secretary, he said, whatever the swimming team needs, you take it. Baki ka mereko malum nahi. Swimming team should get everything, priorities. And that's how I grew in second MBBS. The very first term, surgical clinical term, was surgery. We had walked into a unit with four bosses. Dr. K.C. Mehta, Dr. Sirish Bansali, Dr. P.M. Zaveri, and the lecturer called Percy Chibber. The moment I entered the ward and the very first time I met them, I said, this is what I'm going to do. They were absolutely thorough etiquette, surgeons-like thing. When they entered the ward, patients used to look up to them like that, as if gods are entering in your ward. And I said, this is going to be my passion. I want to take up general surgery. The way they used to teach surgery, like Dr. Percy Chibba, Dr. Bansali, they were teachers par excellence. If you think that I'm a teacher, you should listen to them. 90% of what my teaching is to them what they taught me. And this, I said, is going to be my passion, general surgery, nothing but general surgery. And all throughout my life, I went on studying very hard. At the same time, swimming was that first passion which I can never let go of it. During this period, as I went in, we used to have these rotations, and cardiology department had a rotation over there. We had a professor called Dr. K.D. Shah, another par excellent teacher. And every one of us taught us only one thing, clinical examination, history, how it's important. When you enter the department, I saw my second mantra of my life. The first was courage, knowledge, and confidence. This was the second mantra. He had both put up a board in the Department of Cardiology. The road to success. Late to bed, early to rise. Work like hell, but advertise. That was something which was hit me that time. This is what is missing in my life. People don't know what I'm doing. That's the reason why, the moment I came to third MBBS, I started teaching my juniors, teaching my own batchmates. And among the batchmates, I keep on telling my students even today, when you know something, talk about it. Teach people. The moment you start teaching, your lips start becoming looser, your words come out more easily because you are repeating the same thing again and again. So that's the reason why I started teaching people. I used to always have lots of girlfriends. And the girlfriend means they are girls and they are friends. That's all. don't get into the girls. And they were easy listeners because boys to tapori unka aadha man kitab se hota hai. Girls are attentive. And that's the reason why I took them. They were more than willing, and I was more than willing for the simple reason. I knew one thing, they won't be interested in surgery. So apne liye competition nahi hai. But later on, of course, I realized today that I'm inspiring so many girls to take up surgery. So many girls, I want them to take, because they are as good as any man can do up surgery, and surgery woman can do it. So I used to teach them, so that loosened up my tongue. And end of third MBBS, the passion for doing surgery was so high that I'd finished my Bailey Love inside out 8 times before I appeared for MBBS exam. Clinical Das 3 times inside out, and McGregor, which 2 times inside out. Any page, any anecdote, any small print, I knew inside out. So when I went for my surgery exam, before the exam, people used to come here, important day, important day. Hey, Sharad ko puch yaar, Sharad will let you know. So I used to give like walking, talking, encyclopedia of surgery. And that paid me dividends. I got a distinction in surgery. I came first in the university. And the marks that were there that I got was almost 342 on 400. And the nearest second competitor was 280, 60 marks behind me. There's no question I could not get what I want. But the passion for general surgery was so much. I didn't take orthopedics. I didn't take anything. I said, I want surgery. And that's how I landed in surgery, started romancing with medicine. I started liking that subject. And if you like something, go diligently. That's the way to go for it. And then I took my first house post, 1980. I still remember. Of course, during my internship, that outdoor activity never stopped. I went and did snow skiing, I did roller skating, pistol shooting, karate, volleyball, everywhere I represented. Followed by that, I started my post. This is where the whole story starts. Okay? When I started my first house post was with Dr. Kher, Y.R. Kher, a teacher par excellence, and a very, very sticky fellow for details of every small thing. When he used to take the rounds, every wound he used to open up. Now, I was the houseman. When I look at a houseman, I always feel housemans are the most responsible person in the entire unit. Anything that goes wrong, he is held responsible. But that's a houseman's job. As my boss used to always put, a houseman is always to be seen, never to be heard. You don't talk, you keep on doing the work. The ghada of the unit is basically the houseman. The whole unit rests on it. So he used to keep on opening the dressings every day. Now, because he was opening the dressing, the assistant professor also was worried ki boss going to shout at him. So he also opened the wound. Then the registrar also, the lecturer also, everybody. So as a houseman, I was doing the dressing 4 times in a day. Ek hi bar, wohi dressing chachar bar. Over a period of time, over a period of month, my boss started getting confidence ki this fellow describes the wound very well. He stopped opening. That I felt was my first achievement. Ki my boss has got my trust in me. Came the second story. Now the story starts one by one. there was this patient, I always feel one thing. Every patient has to be worked up properly. Never ever be greedy for work. We have a common lingo in surgical practice, and our units used to have this. One is called HMS syndrome. What is HMS syndrome? Haath Maro syndrome. That means the seniors don't give work to juniors. They keep on doing the work themselves. I'll show you how to do it. And he starts doing it. HMS syndrome. And second is what is called as pruritus digitae. Haath ko khujli aata operation karne. Cutting karne. So these two principles on which every unit is to work. Now my unit had the boss, had a, two assistant boss, two lecturers, two registrars, and two housemans. So this child had come, and this child was 3 years old. He was a barber's son. What taught me, this patience taught me all these things. So he was to, he had tight phimosis, so he said, we'll have to operate him. The registrar, she had just joined as a registrar, suddenly felt intimidated. She says, apne ko routine case mein karega, to ye HMS kha jayega mereko milne wala hai nahi, circumcision. So she told me, we are taking him at 4 o'clock in the evening. OPD 10 o'clock khatam, 12 baje khatam, 4 o'clock we take him up as an emergency. I asked her, would you like to investigate, do something? She said, no investigation, take up. I said, dekha, like that, hemoglobin good, operate, end of it. So we took up the patient. That was the first patient in my life, and probably the last, where we have needed blood for a circumcision. What went wrong? The patient was a hemophilic. And the patient went on bleeding and bleeding and bleeding and bleeding. What went wrong? Had she just done one investigation? But putting up on the routine list would have been troublesome for her, for the simple reason she thought that she's not going to get work. I learned my lesson number one, never be greedy. Never put up an underworked up patient. If it was a female, I wouldn't have bothered because hemophilics were the carriers, but sufferers are the males. And that's the reason why every ENT patient, tonsillectomy, they do BTCT. It's for that reason, to check whether it's a child hemophilic. Adult patient didn't need it for the simple reason, somewhere along those 30, 40 years would have had a fall, hemophilia could have been diagnosed. A child, no. And that was the first lesson I learned. Second patient, see, this is what, first, greed, HMS, don't do it. Second patient, this patient was coming through the casualty. Casualty people felt his abdomen, bang, bent into the ward, peritonitis, open karo. I was a houseman, the first point of contact. I took the history, and when I palpated the tummy, suddenly the patient started jumping into my hand. Opisthotonus, it's a pura upalak. The first question that I asked myself was, if I get pain, if somebody comes close, what do? I withdraw from that pain. I go back, I push the hand away. This fellow is coming into my hand. And when I saw that officer, suddenly first MBBS physiology, the Chatterjee book had showed the opisthotonus position. I said, this is tetanus. So the registrar says, tu kudar se kaya ka diagnosis karta hai, chod na yaar. I said, please call the medical person. And the medical, this is tetanus, shift out. That taught me a lesson also. Believe in yourself, that's the first thing. Believe in yourself, and the things get worked out right. The third case, my teacher used to always tell us this, ki any swelling that comes up, may it be abscess, may it be, we do not know what it is, put a needle inside, aspirate, confirm, make a nick. Now, we had a habit that OPD patients are seen, go into the ward, in the evening, 4 o'clock, start this emergency list, all chota mota abscesses that keep on coming up, so do that. So, my co-houseman was handling the minor surgery, and I was getting late, chale chai peene jayenge jaldi yaar, finish it fast. So this gentleman, there was an abscess on the scalp, and he was about to drain. I said, don't you think you should, our teacher has taught us, why don't you put a needle, aspirate and see what it is. The registrar came and told me, are, kya yaar, don't keep this full-time attitude, chod yourself, don't do all this kind of nonsense, forget the needle, nick maar dosko. He nicked it, and like a municipality ka pipeline jab burst hota hai, blood started shooting up to the ceiling. What went wrong? It was a sarcoid aneurysm. Just one simple needle prick, I would have known there's blood inside and not pus. I would not have touched it. Got the point? And the last story to inspire me, I'll get you one more thing. This story is something worth listening to. Outside Naujivan Society, under that in Lamington Road, the first ladies' bar had opened up. The ladies' bar, where ladies were serving. And that was the first of its kind in Bombay that time, way back in 1980. So this gentleman was the owner sitting there, and the ladies were serving the So obviously, one rowdy fellow, after bouts of alcohol, started manhandling the girl, which the owner didn't like. So he said, started pulling him up. And that fellow pulled out a knife and stabbed him in the owner in the chest here, right into the chest. And I always feel that that was one of the things that I've worked up the fastest. He came to the hospital in the casualty at 10:15. He was stabbed at 10 o'clock. 10:15 he came to the casualty, 10:20 he came to the ward, and 10:30 I shipped him to the theater. I was very proud of it as a houseman. Shaving, beaming, sab karke, I did the shaving myself, everything. Shifted, lift khada kiya, usko niche liya. The registrar came in and they said, let's first put my finger inside, let's see what it is. The anesthetist was called. This was under local anesthesia. Put a finger inside, a lot of gush of blood came out. He said, we'll have to put an intercostal tube. Put an intercostal tube under local. The rule is basically if you have bleeding more than 1 ml per second, that is 60 ml per minute, it indicates there's an active bleed inside. So we said, okay, I think the bleeding is quite a lot, we'll have to open this chest. So the registrar told me, you're the houseman, go and call the lecturer. The lecturer was, then you had a teacher over by Dr. Shilotri, who was here in this hospital. So he was the lecturer that time. So just go and call him from the room, we're just opening up the chest. The local anesthesia was converted by an anesthetist, who I'm still in touch with, fantastic anesthetist. He said, jiye diye diya usko. Thoracotomy kiya, the lecturer were together, they found a lot of lung tears. He sutured the lung, and then he realized there's one opening, the stab had gone through the diaphragm into the abdomen. So this was decided that you have to open the abdomen. So again, houseman called the associate professor. So I washed out, sent a call, ambulance bheja, AP aa gaya. The operation went on from 10:30 that it started, local ka GA, GA ka, went on till 2 o'clock when that associate professor came in. We opened the abdomen. It had missed the liver, went through the transverse colon to the jejunum, multiple perforations. We sutured all of them. By the time all this operation was done, it was nearing about 5:36. One case went on going. Then he said, as usual, the associate professor said, okay, my work is done, you start closing. The moment the associate professor went off, the lecturer said, chalo, mera bhi ho gaya, chal tu band karo. This is the usual story in every unit. And ultimately, it lands up, ki houseman skin sutures leta. And they have gone back to their rooms. 6 baj gaya, soya to kuch nahi. Suture kiya pura diligently, shifted into the ICU. Patient got extubated. And then, meticulous note writing was one of the teachers had taught me. Write everything meticulous. So I started writing all the notes, etc. And I was going through the paper, I suddenly realized that the patient, nobody had taken his consent. And I felt a chill running down my spine. Without consent, we have operated almost 6 hours. If he dies tomorrow, the first thing is, katl mera ho jayega. So once again, consent, which I have not taken, but the presence of mind. I said, thik hai, kuch karenge iska. That fellow, we had not catheterized him also. So I said, dekho, aapka peshab measure karne ka mere ko. So I want to catheterize you. So he said, nahi, nahi, catheterize karega, urine pass karega. Aap jab bolo, tabhi karega. Mani man bola, tu karega, to main mar jaunga idhar yaar. So God was with me that time. He couldn't pass. So I said, sir, pass a catheter. Sign de do idhar yaar. So I took a catheter, a sign. I mean, we have to do that, but something was there. Okay? The story doesn't end there. I mean, how tapori things keep on happening. The story doesn't end there. Consent ho karega, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, the boss used to come for the round. Dr. Kher came for the round. Kher was a very, very good teacher, but he always had a despondent attitude. When I asked, how is the patient doing? I don't know, he might die. Never ever do this to any of your patients. Never show them despair. There's always hope everywhere. So that man's father came into the ICU. He had a walking stick in his hand. And obviously, we were the boss's guardian. Boss, all of us are standing by the side. And this old man asked him, how is my son doing? So as usual, I don't know, he might die. Moment die bola, that old man got infuriated. He pulled out from his walking stick a stab knife, huge lungs. He pulled out from there. Isko to, obviously, hum log to pakda usko kaadar se baju mein nikala, kya kisko nikal gaya? Churi piri baju mein nikal gaya. The patient went home after that. He said, I want to go to Jaslo. Patient got shifted to Jaslo. Knowledge is something which is so difficult. We said, I have to follow this patient up. So every evening we used to go to Jaslo to see that, how is he doing? We met the houseman over there. The caliber of the houseman was, you can see how much he has worked in his life. He says, "Arey boss, tumne operation bahut achha kiya hai. लेकिन वो ट्यूब क्या था चेस्ट के अंदर, रबर का ट्यूब डाला था। आई सेड दैट्स अ इंटरकॉस्टल ट्यूब यार, व्हाट द थोराकोटोमी शुड डू इट, और ट्यूब डाला अंदर, और क्या ट्यूब है तुम्हारा। सो आई सेड ये भाई मेरे बाप, आई होप द पेशेंट गोज होम। पेशेंट वेंट होम। इयर्स लेटर, दिस इज व्हाट आई एम सेइंग, रिकॉर्ड कीपिंग इज इंपॉर्टेंट। इयर्स लेटर आई वाज इन ऑनडी एट राजावाड़ी, दिस वाज वे बैक लेटर ऑन 98 100, दिस वाज 18 इयर्स लेटर। अ पुलिसमैन केम टू राजावाड़ी हॉस्पिटल, आई वाज ऑन द राउंड। ही सेइंग साहब आपके नाम आने वारंट है, मुझे यू शुड गिव अस एक्सपर्ट विटनेस के लिए वारंट है। आई सर वारंट, आई थॉट माय हाउसमैन दे ले रहे क्या, बोलते नहीं साहब तुम्हारे। अरे मेरा 1980 का केस का हियरिंग कभी आया था। सो आई वेंट ओवर देयर एंड आई रियलाइज वन थिंग, नॉट अ रजिस्ट्रार, नो लेक्चरर, नो बडी हैड रिटन एनीथिंग एक्सेप्ट फाइंड माय नोट्स व्हिच आर रिटन मेटिकुलसली, एंड ऑन दैट बेसिस दैट फेलो गॉट कन्विक्टेड ओनली बिकॉज ऑफ माई नोट्स। एंड आई वेंट एंड रेडी बोल तुम्हारा मेरा आए तो एवरी डिटेल इवन ड्यू डेट आई रिमेंबर दैट पेशेंट्स व्हाट वाज द ब्लड लॉस एवरीथिंग। And this is the dedication which I feel always we should work with. Go one step further. Over a period of time, as this houseman taught me everything, I became a registrar. Same thing, I went on, started teaching people. I wanted to make surgery something which is very easy to understand. And the approach to the surgery as well as the craft of surgery should be made easy to every person to understand. I should keep on sitting with the patient, counsel them every time, teach students, keep on doing that. All throughout, till my MS exam came in. And then, first time when I appeared for my MS exam, the first disaster came in the picture. I learned two things when I appeared for the exam. I failed my first time, MS exam. When I went there, the exam was in Sion Hospital. We were from Nair. The two examiners started having some fights because each one wanted to pull his candidates out. And what they did was, everybody else except Sion and KM were passed, rest everybody was failed. This happens sometimes. But I thought to myself, I am not ever going to be a partial examiner ever in my life. Whatever happens, whether it's my student or otherwise. And I can tell you stories later on in my life when I became an examiner also. But that is besides the point. The second thing I've learned, that disaster which hit me that time, for almost 3 months, I was in a solid state of depression. I said, I just didn't know whether should I study further, what the hell is happening. And then suddenly, I said, no, this is not. Just for somebody's fault, why the hell should I suffer? And that's where I said, okay, let me start all over again. And when I started, at the end of the whole thing, when I appeared for the second time, exam was in JJ, it is something different to conquer a battle in somebody else's field. It's always the truth. I was from Nair, went to KM, I went to JJ, sat over there, exam came. All the four, we used to get gradings over there, not marks. The grades were like a G, P plus, P and F, four grades. Four tables, four papers, four tables. Critical case, etc. And I went there, every of those four examiners told me, we have got no more questions for you. Everything, then do what you want, everything, questions were answered. So much so they saying, please doc, please go a little slower. There are so many people trying to listen to you. So turned around, seven of the supervisors trying to listen to what you're doing there. At the end of that, I got 6 G's and 2 P+, which was unheard of record in the University of Mumbai. It was a distinction, and distinction at MS level is somewhere like 90%. This went to FCPS, I got a gold medal there. The passion of studying, the courage to get the skill, and the confidence to implement it. Now, I became a lecturer. I'm going to give you cases which inspired me to get into medicine and to get a passion for medicine. Now, when I went to came as a lecturer, that was the first thing that started. I learned, now is the time to implement whatever I've learned. Get the confidence to implement. That's the next story. As a lecturer, you're totally independent. I learned from watching people around. We had a fantastic anesthetist. One Dr. Dasgupta was there. He was the head of the Department of Anesthesia in KM. Tremendously confident, to an extent that I should always feel he's overconfident. And that sometimes gets your Waterloo across. I had a patient who had a huge thyroid. The thyroid which we, after removing, we weighed it. It was 3.5 kilos of thyroid. That thyroid was there. She has kept it as a family heirloom. She kept it with her for almost 14 or 18 years. That kind of a thing. And by this time, that trachea had become a scabbard trachea. The trachea had shifted to on one side and the right-hand side. And I was trying to tell the anesthetist, see yaar, uska x-ray dekh lo ek baar, theek hai. He said, arre Shanai, you go and wash up. He was that confident always, Shanai, you go and wash up. I'll induce, I'll give a position to wash up karke aaja. So I went to wash up. He gave the propofol, I mean, wasn't propofol that time, it was pentothal. He gave a pentothal and he gave us choline, and then he went to look at the tube, the trachea was not seen. So the trachea deviated so much that he just couldn't see. So by the time I came, the patient had got a cardiac arrest, hypoxia. But look at the confidence of that person. He said, arre Shanai, tera cardiac massage de de usko. So I started cardiac massage diya, heart revived. Then he could manage to pass the tube inside. And I said, sir, postpone kare. Arre kuch nahi, chalo rakh tu yaar. And that was his confidence level that this patient will not suffer. Operated, nikala thyroid pura, patient went home by the 10th day. Without any kind of thing. That was the confidence that he had. He gave us this confidence. Sometime later, I got a gasping patient. Intestinal obstruction, totally gangrenous abdomen inside, because that's what I came to know later on. Intestinal obstruction. Patient was gasping. I told the anesthetist, open to karna padega. I remember that time also, 6:30 in the morning. I asked the anesthetist, kuch de do yaar. Bolte, nahi yaar, tum mare hue patient ko thodi main dunga yaar. I said, okay, fair enough. Do me a favor, just start, keep an oxygen mask. Don't you see that she doesn't realize also what it is. Keep an IV line, I'll do under local anesthesia. That's the first thing. This is what Dasgupta taught us. Give an abdominal block, open the abdomen, resected that 1.5 feet of jejunum which was gangrenous, anastomoted, finished the surgery by 8 o'clock, 6:30 to 8. Patient went home on the 10th day. Gasping patient, pulled them out, sent them home without any trouble. What a mentor should be. That's the next thing which I always felt. I had a boss, Dr. C.V. Patel. I can never forget what he has done for me. He was man par excellent. He was absolutely cool. He taught me in the etiquettes of OT, never shout at anybody. A shouting surgeon always indicates a weak surgeon. He doesn't know what he's doing. So he taught us, never shout at anybody. He says, excessive bleed also, he says, don't worry, we control it. Just to keep a pressure there. Just to our organ external sister, vascular clamp, get everything ready till then, keep a press. Nothing. He taught us how to do nephrectomies. And incidentally, there's one more story about him. He never said anything. He used to always tell me this. I'd asked him once, do we operate our relatives, handshake? So I'd asked him this question. Do you think I should operate on my own relatives? He said, son, try to understand this. If you think you are good and you are the best for it, go ahead and do it. Doesn't make any damn difference whether it's a relative or otherwise. That prompted me later on in life. I had a cut on my face. I sutured it myself. Like Rambo style. The Rambo style. I washed in the mirrors, gave a local anesthesia, stapled myself. That was years later. I can't even see the scar now. So this patient came in. This boy was in love with the girl. And this girl, they were said, let's elope because my parents will not agree. So just before eloping, the brother of the girl came to know. And he came in and stabbed that fellow in the chest with a pen knife, into the chest. So he came to the KM casualty, we admitted him. I said, put in the intercostal drain first because that is the rule. That's the rule usually. Put in the needle inside. Blood was there, put an intercostal drain. He started bleeding. So we know that we have to open up the chest. So converted, open kya. So I told my boss, do you think I should get a cardiac person? He said, of course not. I'm there, go ahead, yes, see. He washed up. We opened the chest. And we found that the knife had gone exactly and touched the ventricle. Pericardium was torn and the ventricle was ruptured. So I said, should I call the cardiologist? Cardiologist, arre chod, we'll do it, don't worry. That's the first time I learned how to suture a ventricle. That's kind of mentorship that I've got. So don't worry. He told me how to suture. When the systole is there, put the needle inside, leave it. Diastole, pick up the needle. Don't do it while contracting. Put, leave. And I sutured. Patient went home. Patient said, doctor sahab, aapne mera jaan bachaya. Bola, tu kuch bhi kar. Agle time bhagne ke pehle. Don't select a Tuesday. Ye to wapas mere paas aa jayega. To mangalwar ko tumhe. Sajag. Koi bhi din bhag to lega. Mangalwar ko mat aana. Okay? Another patient was there. In New Bombay, that time there was no hospitals over here. There's no DIY party in those days. New Bombay, Washi Times editor. His daughter was cycling on the cycling track. a lorry came and knocked her off. Thoracic injury was there. Came to KM Hospital. And I told him, sir, should we send it to the cardiothoracic? I said, well, of course not. We'll do it. Don't worry. You open up. So we opened up the chest, multiple lung injuries. That is the kind of mentorship that we have grown with. Never say no to anything. And he's also cautioned us also. While doing an head, face, neck, we used to do is, he was an oncologist basically. He used to operate. But there was one tumor which was so inoperable. It was so inoperable that he was very, very adamant. So we asked him, sir, Kaduka. He told me also, boy, don't try to be God. I can't forget these words which he says. He said, there are some times you have to accept defeat. We can't do something. Leave her alone. You'll kill the patient otherwise. And this is how I was trained across the place. Now, so far as this romancing with medicine is concerned, this gave me the humility and the knowledge and the craft which molded me to become a career surgeon today. Teaching goes on. Swimming was stopped, but that was there. And then something else also happened over there. At the end of my practice, when I started my practice, at the end of my lecturer's post, I started my practice, my own boss, in the olden times where I was a houseman with him, he said that you have started practice, can you operate on me? So I said, I just started my practice. He said, no, I know your hand, I know what you are, I want you to operate me. That is the crowning glory of any surgeon, when your own teacher comes and tells you, I need you to operate me. I felt maybe I am a little better. That's, I'm not saying I'm good. Now comes the next thing. Romancing with medicine also helped me humble towards other aspects of medicine. It made me, I got the humility of the ki kuch hai. And that is one, how do I deal with death with my patients? That's the first thing. And here is what I want to tell you, a few stories. I always feel I'm not God in the first place. I'm a human being. And there was this patient who had come with a CBD cholangiocarcinoma. She was 74 years old. Severe obstructive jaundice, lots of itching on her body. And she's saying, she was advised by an oncosurgeon, do a Whipple's operation, that will be the best and the easiest way out. So he came to me, I said, see, you're 74. Even if I do a Whipple's for a cholangiocarcinoma, the survival rate is not more than 2%. So what am I trying to look at? Am I trying to show that I'm a bold surgeon, that I can operate on you? Let me give you another choice. I said, getting a surgery done, getting a fistula across, biliary fistula, pancreatic fistula, instead of doing that, do an ERCP, stent to the CBD. Your jaundice will go down, don't worry about it. He just listened to me and he went at this. Appetite came back, jaundice went down, itching went down. She died. Anyway, she was going to die. So I explained to her, 6 months, maybe she'll die. If I operate, 2 months, she'll die. So at 6 months when the mother died, he came and told me this. One of the best advice you have given me, doc. The amount of 6 months of quality time I had with my mother, I never had before. Had I operated her, it would have been a disaster. There's another patient. This is what Dr. C.V. Patel used to teach us. Try not to be God. There's some destinies can't be changed. This is CA stomach had come, pyloric antral growth with mets all around the celiac nodes. And the oncosurgeon said, we'll have to operate. How did she come to me? For the simple reason that I am a cheaper surgeon. So the oncosurgeon said it'll cost about 1.5 lakh rupees. So somebody told him, why didn't you go? Because Rajawadi me dahit. So he'll get the cheaper deal. I said, no problem, please come. Poor or rich, it doesn't matter. We have to see that. I told her one thing, that you will cost, we can do it half the cost also in a private practice, maybe 30, 40,000 instead of the 1.5 lakh. But I'll tell you one thing. So I said, where will you raise the money from? But I'll sell my zameen kheti vagare. I'll put it on Girvi, get the money. I told him, please don't do this. This is something which you should not do. Sell your thing and come here. Do one thing. Your mother is not going to live for more than 6 months. Let me just do a bypass, just do a GJ. She'll eat well. The jaundice is not there, nothing. She'll live comfortably. That's what you want. If I operate, she'll live 3 months, 4 months. If I don't operate, she'll live 3 or 4 months. Then why don't I make her comfortable? That's the concepts of palliative surgery. I just went and did a GJ. She lived well. But that boy came and cried to me when the mother died. Not because he was unhappy, but he said, you have saved my land. I didn't take any loan. It was done free of cost. My family is not starving today. This is what I keep on saying. Death is something which all of us have. But try to make that death very simple to you. At every moment, if you keep on explaining to them, some patients you can pull them out. Others you can't. But you have to be a little One more thing. Alternate medicine and astrology. Many patients come and ask me, should I do homeopathy? I never deny them that. Go ahead and do it, no problem. I'll tell you a few stories. There was this patient, I've got some time now. Okay, I'll tell you a story. Very nice story is this. One of the biggest caterers in Chembur area, very close patients of mine. He said, my father has got gross hematuria. I said, no problem, come down, we'll have a look at you. I took him to just look, did a cystoscopy. I saw lots and lots of benign papillomas, tumors like that, diffuse papillomatosis in the bladder. Benign or malignity comes on the histopath report. So diffuse papillomatosis. In other circumstances, I would have said you need a total cystectomy. There's no question about it, no partial. So we did a TURP of some of them, sent for biopsy. And I explained to him, probably your father will need total cystectomy and ileal condyle. So he told me, Dr. Sapek, if you don't mind, can I do something? Can I go and ask my Guruji about this? I'm telling you the stories because there is some substance in alternate medicine. So he said, mere Guruji hai, and he can I just, I said, please go ahead and talk to him, no problem at all. He went there and came the next day, histopath had not come. He told me, my Guruji has said, this gentleman, whatever operation has been done, that is enough for him. Which should be this month of February. And he said, nothing will happen, he'll come out of this, he'll be completely free of all this illness without doing any further surgeries. And one, if he comes through this, it will come out in the month of September, he'll fall ill again. And if that month goes away, well and good, otherwise he'll die. Such was the magnitude of this. The moment I thought in my mind, as well, because I've seen that lesion. I spoke to the urologist, says, Sharad, why are you throwing in this trap, sir? Chodna, let the report come. And he also said, September, so I thought that possibly the tumor don't operate. He keeps on bleeding, he gets meds. In September, he'll get the meds and he'll die. That's the way I interpret it as a medical person. Histopath report came after 3 days. And the histopath report was surprising. It was a TIS tumor, tumor in situ. Absolutely tumor in situ. And the treatment for that is not cystectomy, but BCG vaccine. So we gave BCG vaccine, instilled in the bladder as a local chemotherapy agent. The tumor disappeared. April when I did, there was not a single shred of a papilloma there. So this astrologer was something to fear. So I waited till September. Beginning in the first week of September, the dad got a stroke. That son of his fought valiantly for the father. Third week of September, the father died. I got little palpitations. Well, ye to kuch alag cheez hai yaar. So I told him, who is this gentleman who says this? He says, Doctor sir, aapko time milega nahi. Aap ek kaam karo, aapka ek photo de do mere khali bas. Usko aapko aapki kundli nikal ke deta hu main. So I gave him a photo of me at Xavier's College with long hair and you won't believe it, what he said. I've still got it in my pocket every day. Each and everything what he said is coming true, what he has said. That's why I fear. Astrology, yes, definitely. I'll tell you another story. There's a fellow called Dongri. This is something which is very hurting me sometimes. He had a colorectal cyst, congenital, rose over a period of time. This colorectal cyst that which came in, somebody told him that if you do not operate, it will rupture and then it will get trouble. So he came to me because he was working in a bank, which a lot of vice presidents were my patients. So when I saw that colorectal cyst, I said, it will never rupture, don't worry. There's no urgency for the surgery. You need surgery, do it anytime you want. He went home, he was very happy with the whole thing. 2-3 months later, he said, hey, Doctor, I want to get it done. I said, why? It's not going to rupture, don't worry about it. And then I want to get it done. Like the true story came later on. So I operated him. One of the most cleanest surgery I ever done so far for a colorectal cyst. The total blood loss was 10 cc's. Even the anesthetist and everybody were applauding, what a wonderful surgery went off. I did an excision, colorectal duodenostomy was done. And to luck has to have it, second day onwards, he settled by the second day, suddenly went in a downhill course. He got pancreatitis, which is a known complication. I never thought that this fellow will get pancreatitis. We have done enough colorectal cyst. He was otherwise healthy. And that pancreatitis pushed him into septicemia, ARDS, till he died. Now, I felt that I was responsible for his death. Even though everything went off well. His wife told me another story. He had a son who was about 7 years old, and he had told his wife he could see future. He could see astrological things. And he told his wife that I may not be seeing my son's 8th birthday. That was in May. I don't think I'll see his 8th birthday. So I said, so what did he say? So he feared that that choledochal cyst is going to rupture and I'm going to die with that. That's the reason why let me get operated. I said, why didn't you tell me this? Mere sar pe boja kyun yaar tere mouth par. It's not fair, na? If you had told me this, I would have told you, I'll take the chance. It's not going to rupture. I can guarantee you that. But somebody had put it in mind he's going to rupture. And he said, this is going to rupture before May and I'm going to die. Had he told me that before, I would have said, no, it won't happen to you. No, it won't. Don't worry about it. Another story, homeopathy. Do we do homeopathy or no? There was a vice principal of a school. And she came with a lump in the breast, which was huge. Skin infiltration, axillary nodes. I said, you are an educated lady, a vice principal. How come you waited for such a long time? She said, no, I had noticed it about 8 months ago. And this lump was a small lump. So I went to my homeopath. The homeopath said, don't worry, leave it to me. I'll cure it, don't worry. And he started giving medicines. Now when they started giving me, I said, did it not grow? He said, after 1 month it went on growing. So I went back to him, so he said that in homeopathy we always increase the symptoms and then bring it down. I said, you are intelligent, don't you think once at least? So end of 6 months he realized ki nahi yaar ye to homeopathy khali badhate ja rahe hai, khub takleef de raha hai mere ko. So she came, I did an FNAC, scan showed positive for Metsod. I said, I can remove the tumor, but I can give you chemotherapy, but I think you have come a little late. Operated, chemo, she died in 6 months time. That's the reason, I'm not saying homeopathy is bad. I'll tell you another story. Inguinal cord structure, solid mass, you know, ultrasound, necrotic mass in the cord structures. I said, this could be a Mets on the testes, lymphatic. Testes was normal. Did an ultrasound, showed a necrotic mass there. And that necrotic mass came in, I said, we'll have to excise it. So I did a high orchidectomy for him, right at the internal ring, testes, everything we removed. The histopath report came as a leiomyosarcoma of the cord. Extremely rare to get this. Now, sarcoma is normally spread by bloodstream. There are no chemotherapy agents for this. So I said, observation, we'll see, I've removed the whole tumor. At the end of 3 months, back came the tumor in the inguinal canal, huge like this. I said, I'm sorry, but I have to operate this again. So I went higher up and I removed the tumor further. Again, a leiomyosarcoma. This time he told me, yeah, I have got this homeopath who's in Pune. This one had come from Ratnagiri. Can I go to him, doctor? I said, of course. I don't have anything to offer you. Why not? So he went there. You won't believe this, that homeopath started the medicine. 1 year later, PET scan is done, normal. 2 years later, PET scan is normal. This is 4.5 years, he's still alive. So do I believe in homeopathy? Of course. Never deny a patient anything. He's happy with homeopathy, do it. When you think it's not succeeding, please come back. No problem at all. You're always there. But you need to explain, and need to accept if there is some alternate things in this medicine, whether it may be astrology, whether it is this. So this is what about my whole journey. Now, let me come back to one last thing. Finally, what is the definition of success in your profession? This is what I wanted to do. Years ago, I'd seen a movie called Bucket List. If any of you have not seen it, please see it. It's one of the best movies I've seen. These two people are there, Morgan Freeman and Jack Nicholson. They know they're dying. And then they see that we have done so many things, not done any so many things, they charted a bucket list. And one of the lists was to see something grand, the pyramids of Egypt. So when they're standing outside the pyramids of Egypt, Morgan Freeman tells him, the pharaohs have got a saying with them, when they die, and when they go to the gates of heaven, the angel asks them two questions. First question is, have you found joy in your life? Which I find, always, I have found joy in my life. The surgery is my joy. Second, has your life found met joy for others? Have you found joy for others in your life? And that is the question for success for me, it means the same. How many hearts I've touched in my life? Money has never been a criteria for me. How many hearts, how many smiles I put on their face? That is what my goal is in life. Money is secondary, money comes, it goes, you can't have any control. But that is what I always feel. Do not run after success, you work. You should work as much as you can. Study with diligence. And that's what I say, romancing of medicine should be a passion, a goal, a zeal and a commitment. And I'm sure all of you all can do it. If I could do it, anybody can do it over here. Go with that passion, and that I'm sure you'll succeed in life.